The years 1844 to 1846 were perhaps the most productive in Keyhart's entire life. In this lecture, we want to explore the series of famous works that he penned during this period, among others, the Philosophical Fragments, The Concept of Anxiety, Prefaces, Stages on Life's Way, and the concluding Unscientific Postscript. These books present a complex series of works, ostensibly authored by different pseudonyms, each with his own agenda and intentions. At first glance, this might all look like a kind of playful chaos or straightforward kind of madness on Keyhart's side. But in this lecture, we'll try to make sense of Keyhart's plan with these works and their complex relations to one another. What we'll see is that many of the main motifs concerning Socrates that Keyhart originally treated in The Concept of Irony now reappear in different contexts in these later works. While Socrates is never again made the central object of investigation, as he was in Keyhart's master's thesis, he nonetheless haunts these later works in ways that are often not so easy to see. We'll explore how Keyhart returns to Socrates repeatedly as a source of inspiration. This is particularly interesting when we consider that these works treat important Christian concepts, such as the incarnation, the revelation, faith, sin, and forgiveness. Many people might think that it's outrageous to believe that a pagan philosopher can help to understand these Christian concepts. Here we catch a glimpse of the radicality of Keyhart's thought. He believes that Socrates has some important insights for Christians today. In one text, Keyhart acknowledges the objection, saying, quote, "True, Socrates was no Christian, that I know." But then Keyhart goes on to make the highly provocative and indeed enigmatic statement. And continue, quote, "I also definitely remain convinced that he, Socrates, has become one." That is, that Socrates has become a Christian. So although Socrates was born and died centuries before Christ and before the birth of Christianity, nonetheless, Keyhart believes that Socrates became a Christian. What could he possibly have meant by this? Keyhart continued with his enormous productivity and published the book Philosophical Fragments, or Fragment of Philosophy, on June the 13th, 1844. Keyhart presents this work under the name of the pseudonym Johannes Climacus, although his own name appears on the title page as the editor of the work. The title of the work as Fragments is often taken as a protest against systematic philosophy. Socrates plays an important role, especially at the beginning of this work. There, Keyhart has his pseudonymous author explore Socrates' role as a teacher. This might strike us at first sight as inconsistent with what he said earlier about Socrates' insistence on his own ignorance and his denial that he ever taught anything. But there's no inconsistency here, and Johannes Climacus emphasizes that, in contrast to the 19th century, which was focused on constructing things and on positive content, quote, "Socrates lacked the positive." What then does Climacus mean here by designating Socrates as a teacher, since usually teachers are thought to convey certain material, or, in Keyhart's language, something positive? Here, Climacus makes reference to Socrates' art of maieutics, or midwifery. Socrates doesn't produce the ideas or thoughts in the student, but rather helps the student to find them within himself. So in this sense, Socrates is a teacher, since he's the occasion for the student to arrive at the truth. But Socrates doesn't teach him the truth. Philosophical Fragments is about the doctrine of the incarnation and the revelation of Jesus Christ. But Keyhart is careful not to mention Jesus by name or to cast the analysis explicitly in terms of Christianity. For this reason, he talks merely about the God without any further designation. The idea is that this could apply to any religion in principle. Keyhart contrasts Socrates' role as midwife with the role of Christ as Savior, who is also the occasion for his followers to learn the truth. Fjord is keen to point out some important contrast between the Socratic model and the Christian model, but the comparison in itself is interesting. While Socrates is obviously not Christian, his idea of midwifery can be useful in helping us to understand the Christian truth. Fjord also uses Socrates to introduce the notion of the absolute paradox. He begins chapter 3 of the work by recounting a passage from Plato's dialogue, The Phaedrus, where Socrates says that he was not interested in exploring the nature of certain mythological creatures, such as Pegasus and the Gorgons, because he was primarily concerned with discovering what he himself was as a human being. He claims to be ignorant of what he himself is and is uncertain whether he might not be a monster like Typhon. Fjord has Johannes Climacus refer to this as a paradox. He defines this as the desire, quote, to want to discover something that thought itself cannot think. For Socrates, this means apparently understanding what he is ultimately as a human being, which he can never quite grasp. The understanding wants to grasp what is unknown and is constantly frustrated when it encounters what is unknown. This unknown must be something absolutely different, since if it were similar to us, then we could know it by recognizing certain aspects of it that we're familiar with. The human mind can't grasp what's absolutely different. Johannes Climacus suggests that we call the unknown the God. The analysis then subtly shifts over into a Christian context, although again, this is not stated explicitly. The unspoken issue is the Christian doctrine of incarnation, according to which God became incarnated as a human being, Jesus Christ, and revealed himself. God is unknown but wants to make himself known by means of the revelation. According to Johannes Climacus, this too involves a paradox. God is infinite and eternal, but yet he became finite and temporal with the incarnation. This seems to be a straightforward contradiction. Climacus calls it a paradox, indeed the absolute paradox. This contradiction is not something that the human mind can grasp or think. It thus stands as a contradiction that we must accept. This is clearly meant as a response to the idea of mediation that was found in the works of figures such as Martinson, who were influenced by Hegel. According to the Hegelian view, there are no absolute dichotomies or contradictions, and everything can be mediated. So, as we've seen, according to Martinson, there's no absolute difference between human and divine, or between finite and infinite, temporal and eternal. Each of these terms is necessarily related to the other, and thus mediated by it. Jointly, they form a higher conceptual structure, since they must be regarded as belonging together organically. When one understands the terms in this way, it's possible to give a philosophical explanation of the incarnation and the revelation of Christ. This is something that can be understood by using Hegel's speculative logic, and there's no contradiction in thinking that God, as the infinite, became finite. It was this explanation that Kierkegaard objected to. With the doctrine of the absolute paradox, he clearly wants to insist that the revelation is an example of an absolutely fixed, irreducible dichotomy, an either-or that cannot be mediated. He uses Socrates as his model, as someone who accepts that there are some things that he cannot know or understand, who accepts that there are some things that must be regarded as paradoxes. Kierkegaard published his next major work on June the 17th, 1844, namely The Concept of Anxiety, which is ascribed to the pseudonymous author Virgilius Hafniensis, or the Watchman of Copenhagen. This work appeared only 4 days after Philosophical Fragments and on the same day as another book entitled Prefaces. The Concept of Anxiety is one of Kierkegaard's most scholarly works, along with The Concept of Irony. It treats the complex set of issues concerning the freedom of the individual and hereditary sin. It's in this context that his influential analysis of anxiety appears. It seems odd, then, that in a work about the Christian dogma of sin, that the pagan philosopher Socrates would play a role. But once again, it's clear that Kierkegaard is constantly looking to Socrates as a model and as a source of inspiration. Socrates is mentioned at the very beginning of the work in the opening motto that follows the title page. he's compared positively to modern philosophy. The motto begins, quote, "The age of making distinctions is past. It has been vanquished by the system." This refers to the Hegelian doctrine of mediation that, as we've seen, brings together opposites, or, as is implied here, eliminates distinctions. By means of Hegel's logic, opposite terms such as being and nothing, finite and infinite, one and many, can be mediated by showing the necessary relation of the one side of the opposition to the other. To hold firmly to one side of an opposite and to fail to recognize the other is, according to Hegel, the sign of dogmatism. For Kierkegaard, by contrast, the key is to keep the oppositions and contradictions in focus and not to mediate them. His slogan, "either or," emphasizes that one is obliged to take one side or the other, and no mediation is possible. Now here, in the motto to the concept of anxiety, Socrates is invoked as someone who, like Kierkegaard, insisted on distinctions. It's noted that this might seem somewhat eccentric in modern times, now that people are used to Hegel's philosophy. Kierkegaard quotes the German philosopher, Johann Georg Hamann, who is also a great admirer of Socrates. Hamann writes, quote, "For Socrates was great in that he distinguished between what he understood and what he did not understand." By using this as the motto of the work, Kierkegaard seems to imply that he wishes to follow the lead of Socrates and insist on unshakable distinctions in order to resist mediation. Kierkegaard dedicated the concept of anxiety to his old teacher, Paul Martin Muller, who had died in 1838. Socrates' name also appears in this dedication when Muller is referred to as, quote, "the confidant of Socrates." This seems to confirm the idea that we discussed earlier, namely that Muller's interest in Socrates and Socratic irony played an important role in Kierkegaard's intellectual development and might well have served as a part of the inspiration for his book, The Concept of Irony. In the introduction to The Concept of Anxiety, Kierkegaard mentions Socrates when he presents the topic of the work, namely the concept of sin. He begins by making the following claim, quote, "Sin does not properly belong in any academic field, but it is the subject of the sermon, in which the single individual speaks as the single individual to the single individual." This assertion will strike theologians as somewhat odd, since traditionally the dogma of sin has belonged to the scholarly field of theology, and specifically dogmatics. Here, at the outset, Kierkegaard has his pseudonymous author indicate that his approach and understanding of sin will be something very different indeed, something at odds with the scholarly account. Also somewhat odd is his description of a sermon. Usually we think of a sermon as something like a lecture, where a priest or a pastor explains a certain biblical passage or idea to the congregation. But also here, Kierkegaard wants to signal a different understanding. While he admits that some pastors in his own day have been corrupted by scholarship and recent philosophical trends, and thus give sermons that sound like lectures, this is not the true nature of the sermon. Then comes the truly surprising passage. Kierkegaard writes, "But to preach is really the most difficult of all arts, and is essentially the art that Socrates praised, the art of being able to converse." This seems very odd, since Socrates, of course, never attended a Christian church service and never heard a sermon in his entire life. But Kierkegaard has Virgilius Haufniensis compare Socrates' form of conversing and discussing with a Christian sermon. The key term in both cases is what Kierkegaard refers to as appropriation. The idea for Socrates is that through his questioning and conversation, the individual is led to find the truth within himself. This means taking something and giving it their own interpretation or appropriation in one's own special context. So also with the sermon, the pastor, instead of simply preaching some external fact or bit of knowledge, encourages the individual members of the congregation to find the truth of Christianity in themselves, each in their own way. Every follower of Christ must appropriate the Christian message for him or herself. So for Kierkegaard, the key here is that the truth, both for Socrates and for Christianity, is something inward that must be appropriated by people as individuals. So even though Socrates is not a Christian thinker, he can nonetheless give us insight into Christianity. In chapter 4 of The Concept of Anxiety, Kierkegaard again has his pseudonymous author contrast Socrates with modern philosophy, and especially Hegel. This appears in the context of a discussion of the notion of negation and what Kierkegaard refers to as enclosed reserve. The Danish term that's translated as enclosed reserved is indsluttethed, and it means literally something like closing oneself off from the world or from other people. It's natural to understand negativity in this context, since when one is closed off into oneself, it can be said that one negates the outside world. We've seen how important negation is in Kierkegaard's understanding of irony. In the passage in question from The Concept of Anxiety, reference is made to Hegel's treatment of Socrates, which we studied earlier in this course. Kierkegaard writes, quote, "Thus irony has been explained as the negative. Hegel was the first to discover this explanation, but strangely enough, he did not know much about irony." Hegel's lack of understanding is then contrasted to Socrates' full appreciation of the importance of irony. Kierkegaard continues in the same passage, quote, "that it was Socrates who first introduced irony into the world and gave a name to the child, that this irony was precisely enclosing reserve, which began by closing himself off from men, by closing himself in within himself, in order to be expanded in the divine. This is something that no one is concerned with." Here, Kierkegaard again emphasizes the element of subjectivity that Socrates introduced. There's something infinitely important and valuable in each and every individual, but to get to this, one must occasionally get away from the crowd and from other people. This distancing oneself from others involves negation and irony. One must instead focus on one's own inwardness and religiosity. Kierkegaard takes Socrates to be the first one to have realized this. Here again, we see an intriguing juxtaposition of an issue concerning Christian faith and the practice of a pagan philosopher, which Kierkegaard uses as a model. Enclosed reserve is another important Kierkegaardian concept that makes use of the idea of negation and irony from Socrates. We saw in the sixth lecture how the critic Johann Ludwig Heiberg wrote a critical review of Either-Or that earned him Kierkegaard's animosity. While Kierkegaard responded with the article, "A Word of Thanks to Professor Heiberg," this was by no means the end of the conflict. Heiberg was known for his famous literary journals, such as Copenhagen's Fluvende Post or Copenhagen's Flying Post. At the beginning of 1844, Heiberg funded a new journal entitled Urania, which had an entirely new profile. At this time, Heiberg had become interested in astronomy, and this journal was intended to encourage new research in this field. It was on the second floor of this house, where Heiberg lived at that time, where he built his own private observatory. In the first issue of his new journal, Heiberg wrote an article entitled The Astronomical Year. In this piece, he discusses the various changes that occur in nature, such as the movements of the planets and the changing of the seasons. In this context, he comes to mention Kierkegaard's new book, Repetition. He writes, quote, "In a recently published work, which even has the word repetition as its title, something very beautiful and fitting is said about this concept. But the author has not distinguished between the essentially different meanings which repetition has in the sphere of nature and in the sphere of spirit." As in his earlier review of Either-Or, Heiberg initially acknowledges something positive in Kierkegaard's work, but then criticizes it for misunderstanding something quite fundamental. Kierkegaard was angered by Heiberg's remarks here, just as he had been angered by the previous review of Either-Or. He drafted a couple of different articles in response to Heiberg, but in the end, he never published these. Kierkegaard saved his polemical response to Heiberg for his next book, entitled simply Prefaces. This book appeared on June the 17th, 1844, and is written under the guise of the pseudonymous author Nicholas Notabene. This is a somewhat odd book in that it consists of a series of different prefaces to other texts which were never written. It appears that Curard had a handful of unused texts just lying around, but they could not be really used for anything. Some of these texts included materials relevant for his criticism of Heiberg. So Curard hit upon the idea of publishing them in a single text with the title Prefaces. He had to give some kind of reason for why these texts were presented in this odd way, and so he concocted the following story. The author, Nicholas Notabene, is a married man, and his wife is angry with him because he spends so much time writing books and not enough time with her. So she forbids him from writing books. Notabene, however, is enamored in writing and can't desist, and so he tries to get around his wife's prohibition by writing not books, but instead just prefaces. This explains why the book consists of a series of 8 prefaces that, in a sense, stand alone and are not prefaces to any particular book. In the work, Heiberg is mentioned directly several times, and in some passages, the perceptive reader can recognize Kierhard's response to both the review of Either-Or and the critical discussion of repetition. Indeed, Notabene criticizes the entire culture of literary critics and the industry of book reviews in the second preface. As we saw in Lecture 6 in his article, A Word of Thanks to Professor Heiberg, Kierhard satirized Heiberg's constant use of the impersonal pronoun one in his review of Either-Or. Now here, in the fourth of the prefaces, he does the same thing when he writes, quote, "What, I wonder, will one say about this book now? My dear reader, if you're not able to find out in any other way, then our literary telegraph manager, Professor Heiberg, will probably be kind enough to be a tax collector again and tally the votes, just as he did in connection with Either-Or." So it seems that one of Kierhard's primary goals in prefaces was to criticize Heiberg and certain things that he stands for in the public eye, such as literary criticism and Hegelian philosophy. As a young man, Johann Ludwig Heiberg lived in a house in Gammelstrand, just about 50 meters from here. The house was located just across the canal, facing the royal palace. The last of Kierhard's prefaces, namely preface number 8, is also a criticism of Heiberg, but it's particularly interesting for our purposes, since in it, Kierhard again employs some of the strategies that he learned from Socrates. This preface is ostensibly a preface to a new philosophical journal that Nicholas Notabene wants to found. He begins by referring to Heiberg's philosophical journal, Perseus, which began in 1837. The subtitle of Perseus is A Journal for the Speculative Idea, which indicates Heiberg's intention. This journal is supposed to serve the purpose of spreading information about Hegel's speculative philosophy in Denmark. In the end, Heiberg's journal saw only 2 issues, in 1837 and 1838, and was then discontinued. Nicholas Notabene then contemplates his own prospects of succeeding with the new philosophical journal, given that Heiberg's journal didn't flourish, despite the fact that Heiberg had extensive editorial experience and academic connections. Nicholas Notabene recalls that Heiberg, in his treatise on the significance of philosophy for the present age, claimed that philosophy was the demand of the age, or in other words, philosophy what was needed to help the age get past the forms of relativism, subjectivism, and so that were so dominant at the time. Given this diagnosis, Heiberg's attempt to found a new philosophical journal makes perfect sense. He takes this to be the cure for the ills of the day. Nicholas Notabene says that he too wants to serve philosophy with his new journal, but his service is quite different from that of Heiberg's journal. Instead of using his journal to explain philosophy to his readers, as Heiberg does, Notabene admits openly that he doesn't understand philosophy and that his journal will invite contributors to explain it to him. Notabene asks for the approval of his readers when he explains his goal to work for philosophy by asking people to teach him about it. Quote, "Isn't this purpose good, and isn't it different from that of those who heretofore have tried to publish a philosophical journal, even if it's not in harmony with theirs, in wanting to serve philosophy? Yet the services are different. One serves it with wisdom, another with his stupidity." Just as Socrates claimed to know nothing, Notabene claims to be straightforwardly stupid. Notabene refers to himself in an entirely humble and self-effacing manner while at the same time recognizing Heiberg as one of the leading cultural figures in Danish letters at the time. Just as Socrates invites others to teach him and to explain to him what they know, so also Nota Bene invites contributors to his journal who can teach him and explain him the new philosophy. Like Socrates, Nota Bene refrains from making any positive claims himself, but instead simply listens to the claims of others and critically evaluates them. Heiberg was, of course, known for his promotion of Hegel's philosophy in Denmark, and so Nota Bene grants that Hegel's philosophy has explained everything. This is the same as Socrates' point of departure. He always grants immediately the claims of his interlocutors to know something. Nota Bene merely states that he doesn't understand the account that Hegel's philosophy gives, and so he politely asks for an explanation of it. So also Socrates, after having heard the explanations or definitions given by his interlocutors, claims not to fully understand their explanation, and so he begins to ask follow-up questions, which reveal that the explanation is contradictory and thus unsatisfying. Nota Bene then, like Socrates, ironically states his expectation to be enlightened about this. Quote, "Since we now have so many philosophers here in Denmark who, with industry and good fortune, have comprehended this philosophy, I happily expect the instruction for which I have wished." Socrates often begins by flattering his interlocutors for the knowledge they possess, thereby making it more difficult for them to refuse to answer his questions after they have accepted his recognition. So also Nota Bene seems to oblige the Danish followers of Hegel to respond, since they're publicly known to have an understanding of Hegel's philosophy, which Nota Bene is the first to recognize. But given their public reputation as experts in this philosophy, these people, like Heiberg, have no excuse for not responding, as it were, to Nota Bene's call for papers. With this context set up in this way, it is Heiberg who appears in the role of one of Socrates' interlocutors, perhaps even one of the sophists, someone who claims to know things and to teach things, but who, in fact, is ignorant, and even ignorant of his own ignorance. Here we can see how Kihor takes his initial inspiration from Socrates and then translates it into his own modern Danish cultural milieu. Kierhard's next important work was Stages on Life's Way, which appeared on April the 30th, 1845. This is another complex pseudonymous book that in many ways recalls Either Or and seems to be a kind of sequel to it. The pendant to Victor Eremita from Either Or is Hilarius Bobinder, the pseudonymous editor responsible for the publication of the new book. Like Victor Eremita, Hilarius Bobinder claims to have found texts that constitute the work. The book consists of three long chapters with what amount to four different texts by four different authors. First, there's In Vino Veritas, which is attributed to William Afam. Then there's a text entitled Some Reflections on Marriage in Answer to Objections, which is written by a married man, that is, Judge William, the author of the second part of Either Or. Finally, the third large chapter consists of two works. There's a text entitled Guilty, Not Guilty by Quidem, the Latin name for someone. With respect to form, this text recalls The Seducer's Diary from Either Or. It's the story of a young man who, like Kihord, breaks off an engagement to his beloved fiancée. And as the title indicates, it's a meditation on his degree of culpability in the matter. This inspires another long text called Letter to the Reader by Frater Taciturnus, who claims to have found the manuscript of Guilty, Not Guilty at the bottom of a lake. Stages on Life's Way thus represents a complex embedding of stories within stories. While readers have been quick to try to identify Kihord with, for example, Quidem, it's clear that the text as a whole is set up in a way such that Kihord himself hides behind the different authors. Not only is the work pseudonymous, but it also contains a handful of different authors with convoluted relations to one another. There are thus many different levels of distancing of Kihord as an author from the texts that comprise the work. Kihord's use of Socrates, or Socratic strategy, does, however, play an unmistakable role here. Indeed, Socrates is mentioned in all of the texts that appear in the book, Perhaps most notable is the section In Vino Veritas, where one can see clear signs of this influence. The title In Vino Veritas is Latin and means simply in wine the truth. That is, when people drink, they lose their inhibitions and speak the truth. The text presents a series of speeches at a dinner party on the subject of love. The participants in the dinner party who give the speeches are well-known Kierkegaardian pseudonyms: Johannes the Seducer, Victor Eremita, Constantine Constantius, and the young man from Repetition. The model that Kierkegaard uses for In Vino Veritas is clearly Plato's dialogue, The Symposium, which likewise presents a banquet scene and a series of speeches on the topic of love. Kierkegaard self-consciously uses the Platonic dialogue to stage his own symposium with its own speeches. Towards the end of Stages on Life's Way, in the letter to the reader, Frater Taciturnus discusses the religious question of sin and forgiveness. He understands the original state of human beings as that of immediacy, that is, living in immediate harmony with nature and the world. Then there is sin, and the immediacy is broken. This is the stage of reflection. The religious question is how to return to immediacy and undo the damage done by sin. Frater Taciturnus talks about a third stage as the forgiveness of sin. This is what he refers to as a second immediacy. The harmony between humans and the world is restored, but it's no longer the same harmony as at the beginning. Clearly, he has in mind here the Christian doctrine of the forgiveness of sin by means of Jesus Christ. Socrates is invoked in this context. Frater Taciturnus emphasizes the difficulty of the Christian doctrine and warns against those people who claim to understand it. Here, he's presumably referring to the academic theologians or well-educated clergy of the day. He notes that he is aware that in the eyes of such people, he will be regarded as a stupid person who asks foolish questions. But he says that it doesn't bother him to be regarded in this way. Indeed, this was the way that many people regarded Socrates, who said that he didn't know anything and pestered people with his questions. In the passage, Frater Taciturnus imagines what Socrates would say about the issue of sin and forgiveness and the responses of Kierkegaard's contemporaries. He has Socrates say, quote, "Surely what you are asking about is a difficult matter, and it has always amazed me that so many could believe that they understood a teaching such as that. But it had amazed me even more that some people have even understood much more." Here we can see Kierkegaard, through his pseudonym, again taking up a Socratic position vis-a-vis his contemporaries. He recognizes the difficulty and complexity of the issue, which the others fail to see. What does it mean to say that our sins are forgiven in Christ? He's content to remain in the situation of ignorance and uncertainty, even if this means being the subject of public ridicule. This disposition reflects, in his eyes, the contradictory, paradoxical, and absurd nature of Christian belief that his contemporaries fail to appreciate. He thus invokes Socrates to help in maintaining the correct disposition towards these issues. Once again, although it seems odd for us to imagine Socrates helping people to understand a Christian doctrine, Kierkegaard finds it extremely useful, and for this reason, he returns to Socrates repeatedly as a model to follow. One of the best-known parts of Kierkegaard's biography is his famous conflict with the satirical journal The Corsair. In Kierkegaard's time, this was a highly popular publication that featured humorous articles that made fun of well-known figures. The articles were often accompanied by cartoons and comic illustrations that delighted the readers. This journal was published by a talented writer named Meyer Goldschmidt, who continually found himself in legal trouble due to the journal's frequent conflict with the Danish censors. In order to avoid the problem, Goldschmidt had to engage a series of proxy editors who on paper were responsible for the journal, while he himself ran things behind the scene. Thus, when the authorities tried to prosecute the Corsair with legal action, they had no other recourse but to punish the proxy editor who was legally responsible. Goldschmidt's colleague at the Journal was another highly talented and promising young writer and critic by the name of Peter Ludwig Müller, who played a key role in the conflict with Kierkegaard. At the time of the conflict, Müller lived in a house in Stor Kongensgade. Kierkegaard is known for his great animosity towards Goldschmidt and the Corsair, but this wasn't always the case. Prior to the actual conflict, the two had known about each other for about 10 years and were in fact on fairly good terms. Indeed, in 1841, the Corsair published a book review of Kierkegaard's The Concept of Irony, and there was no problem or conflict in that initial context. Similarly, in 1843, the Corsair published a positive review of Either Or that recognized Kierkegaard's gifts as a writer. The controversy itself began at the end of 1845 with a review of Stages on Life's Way by Peter Ludwig Müller. Oddly, although this was the beginning of Kierkegaard's conflict with the Corsair, Müller's review was published not in that journal, but in his own publication, entitled Gaia. It was not uncommon for scholars and literary writers of the time to publish their own journals in this way. Indeed, we need only recall Kierkegaard's publication of The Moment some years later. Müller's journal Gaia was, unlike the Corsair, a very serious organ for literary criticism. It was here that Müller published an article entitled A Visit to Suru, which was, in effect, a critical treatment of Kierkegaard's Stages on Life's Way. Suru is a small town in Denmark that was the home of the famous Suru Academy, which employed a number of famous scholars and writers. One of these was the poet and novelist Carsten Hauch. In his article, Müller creates a fictional dialogue that is said to take place at Hauch's home in Suru, where Kierkegaard's Stages on Life's Way is the central object of discussion. There, Kierkegaard's work is criticized for its awkward style and for the way in which the author puts his own ethical development on show. Kierkegaard responded to this article with a piece of his own entitled The Activity of a Traveling Aesthetician and How He Still Happened to Pay for the Dinner. This article was published in the journal The Fatherland on December the 27th, 1845, and it appeared under the name of his pseudonym, Frater Taciturninus, that is, the pseudonym of Stages on Life's Way. Kierkegaard refuses to engage in any of the substantial criticisms of his work that were raised by Müller. Rather, he implies that Müller is trying to win public acclaim by associating himself with the literary elite of the day, by, among other things, placing the discussion of Kierkegaard's book at the home of Carsten Hauch. So at the end of the article, Kierkegaard associates Müller with the Corsair, even though, as we just mentioned, Müller's initial articles appeared in the journal Gaia and not in Goldschmidt's Corsair. Kierkegaard's point was, in effect, to show that while Müller was pretending to associate on friendly terms with the sophisticated literary elite of the country, in fact, he was writing for a journal of ill repute. So he sarcastically invites Müller to show his true colors and to criticize him in the Corsair. Now, why is that so important, so significant? This was a serious breach of academic ethics at the time. While Müller had collaborated with Goldschmidt on the Corsair, this was a secret between them. Müller was hoping for an appointment at the University of Copenhagen, and so he was keen to present himself as a serious literary scholar and not as someone who was writing for a disreputable journal. In private conversations, Goldschmidt had assured Kierkegaard that he alone was responsible for the Corsair. He warned Kierkegaard not to implicate Müller in this, but his pleas were to no avail. This had serious consequences for Müller's career and perhaps ultimately ruined his chances for academic employment. But an alternative interpretation might say that Müller's chances at a professorship were undermined not so much by his association with the Corsair, but rather by the general perception that Kierkegaard had gotten the better of him in the debate. Müller attempted to respond to Kierkegaard's article 2 days later, also in the paper The Fatherland, that is, the paper where Kierkegaard's original piece appeared. Müller tries to deflect Kierkegaard's ad hominem criticism by saying that the dialogue he presented in his article was, of course, fictional, and thus there's no attempt to gain importance by associating himself with literary figures such as Carsten Hauch. Melchior then in turn responded to this soon thereafter in an article entitled "The Dialectical Result of a Literary Police Action." This was a serious attack on the Khorzar that deeply vexed Müller, who saw his reputation damaged forever. Kierkegaard, again in the name of Frater Taciturnus, compares the Khorzar with a prostitute and emphasizes its goal to make money at the expense of others. This was Kierkegaard's last article in the conflict, but the damage was done. Over the next few years, Kierkegaard was frequently mentioned in a satirical way in the Khorzar, and even worse, he was depicted in masterfully executed cartoon sketches that made fun of both his person and his writings. Kierkegaard felt humiliated when he found himself to be the object of public ridicule in this way. He'd always taken great care to cultivate a certain public image of himself and to maintain a certain relation to his readers, but now he saw that these things were not entirely in his own control. He believed that the Khorzar was intent on ruining his reputation and came to regard himself as a martyr of unfair public opinion. He developed an uncompromising hatred towards primarily Goldschmidt for his role in all of this. Kierkegaard's journals are full of statements of wrath against Müller, Goldschmidt, and the Khorzar. Even when this material was published after Kierkegaard's death, Goldschmidt himself showed great magnanimity in the matter and refused to criticize Kierkegaard as a person, despite the abuse that Kierkegaard unreservedly hurled at him. In any case, this was, without a doubt, one of the signal controversies in Danish literary history that left its marks on all three of the main figures who were involved in it. Kierkegaard published the concluding unscientific postscript on February the 28th, 1846. This is regarded by many as his magnum opus, and Kierkegaard himself indicates that it played a very special role for him in the development of his work. The full title of the book is The Concluding Unscientific Postscript to Philosophical Fragments, a Mimical, Pathetical, Dialectical Compilation, an Existential Contribution. The work is thus conceived as the sequel to the Philosophical Fragments, and for this reason, it's ascribed to the same pseudonymous author of that work, Johannes Climacus. We know that Kierkegaard liked to take walks here in Frederiksberg Garden, which is located in a suburb of Copenhagen, about a 30-minute walk from the old city. In the postscript, his pseudonymous author, Johannes Climacus, recounts that 4 years previously, he came here one Sunday afternoon and sat outside this cafe here, smoking a cigar. He claims that at this time, he was considering the idea of becoming an author. One's tempted to read this story of Johannes Climacus biographically, or say autobiographically, as referring to Kierkegaard himself. We know that 4 years prior to the postscript, that is in 1842, Kierkegaard was just returning from Berlin and was in fact contemplating what he wanted to do with his life. It was presumably during this time that he hit upon the idea of becoming an author and constructing his authorship with a series of pseudonymous and signed works. In any case, the point of Johannes Climacus telling this story about the beginning of his authorship and his initial inspirations is to contrast this account in a humorous way with the account told by Johann Ludwig Heiberg of his conversion to Hegel's philosophy. As we discussed in the fourth lecture, Heiberg attended Hegel's lectures in Berlin, and he gives a very excited and romanticized account of his first great insight into Hegel's philosophy, which served as the inspiration for many of his later works. He describes this as a kind of epiphany that he experienced on his return from Berlin to Kiel. Heiberg writes, and I quote, "While resting on the way home in Hamburg, where I stayed 6 weeks before returning to Kiel, and during that time was constantly pondering what was still obscure to me, it happened one day that, sitting in my room in the inn, the König von England, with Hegel on my table and in my thoughts, and listening at the same time to the beautiful hymns which sounded almost unceasingly from the chimes of St. Peter's Church, suddenly, in a way which I have experienced neither before nor since, I was gripped by a momentary inner vision, as if a flash of lightning had illuminated the whole region for me and awakened in me the theretofore hidden central thought. From this moment, the system, in its broad outline, was clear to me, and I was completely convinced that I had grasped it in its innermost core, regardless of however much there might be in the details, which I had still not made my own, and perhaps never will. Kierkegaard has Johannes Climacus satirize this account by referring to Heiberg as Dr. Hjortspring. He makes fun of Heiberg's conversion to Hegel's philosophy as a miracle that took place at Hotel Streit in Hamburg. By contrast, Johannes Climacus gives a humble account of his own beginnings and his limited contributions to Danish literature. There's nothing romanticized about his portrayal of his decision to become an author here in Frederiksberg Garden. Climacus explains that as he sat here in the cafe with his cigar, he reflected on how he was getting older and still had not taken on any vocation. He saw other men with great talent working hard in different fields in order to make life easier. He recalls the different technological advances of the day, such as steamships and railroads. Similarly, Heiberg, by popularizing Hegel's philosophy, makes it easier for people to understand the German philosopher's difficult philosophical system. When Climacus considered what these other people were doing with their lives and how they were benefiting the age, the inevitable question arose about what he was doing with his life. He then hit upon the idea of what his vocation should be. He would benefit the age not by making things easier, but rather by making something more difficult. He points out that there's a danger in an age when things become too easy, and so it's important to have someone who can guard against this danger and point out the difficulties. All this might sound simply like Kierkegaard playing a joke on us, and to be sure there is an ironical or satirical tone in these passages, but there's also something very serious about it. He refers to the Philosophical Fragments, the first work by Johannes Climacus. One of the goals of that book was, in a sense, to make the belief in Christianity more difficult by the analysis of the absolute paradox. So when Climacus says here that his planned life vocation was to make things difficult, he means more specifically the idea of revising the conception of Christianity of the day and making it more difficult. This seems clearly to be Kierkegaard's own task, and he seemed clearly to regard Socrates as a model for it.
In one chapter, Kierkegaard has his pseudonymous author Johannes Climacus go through and explain the goals and strategy of his previous work, The Philosophical Fragments. At the end of his discussion, there's an interesting comparison with Socrates. Climacus states that his intention was not to elaborate on Christian doctrine or dogma, but rather to address the question of how one becomes a Christian. In this context, he says something that's quite counterintuitive. The missionary tradition in Christianity has a set of well-known pattern for how Christians explain to non-Christians what Christianity is. The goal of the missionary is to convert the non-believer. This means conversion is usually about arguments and different forms of persuasion. The missionary tries to demonstrate the confusion and contradictions involved in the non-believer's worldview and the consistency and plausibility of Christianity. The whole point of this exercise is to show that it's attractive to be a Christian and unattractive to be a non-believer. Now, against this background, it's very odd when Johannes Climacus says that his goal is not to make becoming and being a Christian easier, but rather more difficult. He writes, I quote, "I venture, according to my poor ability, to take on responsibility of making it as difficult as possible." This seems a very odd thing to say. Is the meaning of this that Johannes Climacus is a kind of anti-missionary whose goal is not to persuade people from becoming Christians, but rather to do just the opposite, to repel them from Christianity? The key here is to understand what he means by Christianity. Since Christianity promises salvation and eternal happiness, it's a matter of the utmost importance to be sure about. It would be disastrous if one believed that one was a Christian, but yet in fact was not, since one had a mistaken conception of what Christianity was. Kierkegaard believes that the understanding and practice of Christianity in his own day is largely misconceived and deviates radically from the original Christianity taught by Jesus. The conception of Christianity is much more difficult to live up to in the watered-down modern version. So when Climacus says that his goal is to make it more difficult to be a Christian, he doesn't mean that he wants to destroy or undermine Christianity per se, but only what he regards as a certain mistaken version of Christianity that makes things too easy. This needs to be undermined so that one can come to grasp the true version of Christianity, which is more difficult. According to Climacus, Christianity concerns the inwardness of each individual and not discursive arguments or demonstrations. He objects to the idea that Christianity is a doctrine. This is also a radical and counterintuitive claim. Throughout the history of Christianity, there have constantly been attempts to formalize the teachings of Christ as a fixed doctrine. This began with the very first church councils and continued through history, with countless theologians and scholars developing their own system of Christian dogmatics, that is, the field of theology that tries to understand the different dogmas. Moreover, the religious controversies that led to schisms in the history of the church concerned disputes about the interpretation of specific dogmas or doctrines. In religious wars, people fought and died for what they believed to be the truth of specific doctrines. Likewise, people were persecuted and tortured, even executed, for not believing in certain doctrines. Now, given all this, it's strikingly odd when Johannes Climacus implies that it's a mistake to understand Christianity as a doctrine. He writes, I quote, "The introducing that I take upon myself consists by repelling and making it difficult to become a Christian, and understands Christianity not as a doctrine, but as an existence contradiction and existence communication." His point is that there is a contradiction at the heart of Christianity, presumably that of the idea of God becoming man, the infinite becoming finite, the eternal becoming temporal, in short, the idea of the paradox explored in the philosophical fragments. But as we've seen, this isn't a positive doctrine, but rather stands in the way of one. It's a declaration that this key point in Christianity can never be comprehended by the human mind. It can never be explained to another person. Rather, it must simply be accepted in the inwardness of one's own heart. This seems to be what Climacus means in the passage with an existence communication, which is just the opposite of an objective, direct, or straightforward communication of a fact about the world. Instead, an existence communication concerns something that's paradoxical, contradictory, and absurd. Towards the end of this discussion, Kierkegaard has Johannes Climacus compare his approach with that of Socrates. He refers specifically to the dialogue, The Greater Hippias, which concerns the question of the nature of beauty. Just as Climacus wants to introduce people to Christianity, so also the goal of Plato's dialogues is to introduce people to the concept of beauty. This is one of Plato's so-called aporetic dialogues, and so after many failed attempts to define beauty, the discussion ends with no conclusion. At the end, Socrates states simply that he has benefited from the conversation, since he found the issue of defining beauty to be so difficult. Johannes Climacus sees this as an analogy to his approach to Christianity. He doesn't attempt to teach any positive doctrine about what Christianity is, just as Socrates doesn't attempt to teach a single straightforward definition of beauty. Instead, the idea of Christianity and the concept of beauty are themselves problematized. Climacus takes this to be important and indeed beneficial in his own age, which, in his opinion, is dominated by confused and mistaken conceptions of Christianity. So, if readers can come away from his text questioning and doubting their views of Christianity, then this is an important result, even if he's not taught them a positive doctrine. So here again, we see Socrates providing a model for Kierkegaard's project. Like the Socrates of the Greater Hippias, who makes things more difficult with regard to the concept of beauty, so also Kierkegaard sees himself as making things more difficult with regard to Christianity. Why did Kierkegaard regard the concluding unscientific postscript as such an important work? The key lies in the word concluding in the title. The obvious interpretation of this term is that the work is intended as the sequel to the philosophical fragments and is thus intended to conclude or complete that work. But there's also a deeper biographical explanation. As we know, all of Kierkegaard's siblings, with the exception of his elder brother, died a premature death.
Needless to say, this had a profound effect on him. He developed the idea that he too would die before he reached the age of 34. In his recollections of Kierkegaard, Hans Bruckner records this when he writes, quote, "Kierkegaard once told me that as a young man, he had for many years had a firm conviction that he would die when he reached the age of 33. Was it Jesus' age that was also to be the norm for Jesus' imitator?" Here, Bruckner himself seems a bit uncertain about why Kierkegaard thought he would die at exactly the age of 33, but speculates that since this was the age of Jesus at his death, this was one aspect of Jesus' life that Kierkegaard associated with his own. When he reached the age of 34, still alive and well, Kierkegaard couldn't bring himself to believe it and even checked the official registry to see if the date of his birth had been recorded correctly. In his account, Bruckner adds, quote, "This belief was so ingrained in him that when he did not reach this age, he even checked in the parish records to see if it were really true. That is how difficult it was for him to believe it." In any case, this meant that as Kierkegaard was writing his famous works, he always had in the back of his mind that he only had a few years left to live. He thus strategically planned his works in such a way that they would culminate in one final work, which would be the concluding unscientific postscript. This would be the work that brought together the different strands of his authorship. Since Kierkegaard believed that he would die after the publication of the postscript in 1846, he decided to make a statement about his works as a whole at the end of the book, presumably thinking that this would be his last chance to do so. Once he had completed the book, he then added, at the very end, a final section titled First and Last Explanation. This seems to have been almost an afterthought, since it appears on unnumbered pages, which also seems to separate this final text from the body of the concluding unscientific postscript. Throughout the years prior to this, Kierkegaard had been meticulous about keeping up the facade of the pseudonymous authors that he had created. He went to great lengths to distance himself from his works and to see to it that they were attributed to the fictional authors. As we've seen, when Heiberg criticized Either Or, Kierkegaard responded in an article, Public Confession, not in his own name, but in the name of the pseudonymous editor of the work, Victor Eremita. Kierkegaard was assisted in this attempt to present the pseudonyms as real authors by the literary customs of the day. In Golden Age Denmark, there was nothing new or original about writing in pseudonyms, and many of the great figures of the day also made use of them. Scholarly etiquette of the time dictated that as a reader or critic, one respect the pseudonym and not betray that one knew who the actual author was. Thus, in Heiberg's criticism of Either Or, he's careful never to mention Kierkegaard by name. Likewise, throughout the entire conflict with the Korsar, even though Kierkegaard had named Peter Ludwig Müller directly and associated him with the journal, neither Müller nor Goldschmidt ever mentioned Kierkegaard's name directly in print. Now here, in A First and Last Explanation, Kierkegaard takes an extraordinary and unprecedented step. He reveals that he's the author of the series of pseudonymous works leading up to and including the postscript itself. It seems on the face of it that his main goal was just to make it known that he was the author of Either Or, Fear and Trembling, and so forth, if he should die and people didn't know. In this sense, it seems in many ways natural that he would want to take credit for his work of so many years. But the matter is not quite so straightforward, since once he states this, he goes on to make a request of his readers, namely, that when they refer to a work, they attribute it not to him, but to the pseudonymous author. So while Kierkegaard claims legal responsibility for the pseudonymous works, he seems to want to maintain a distance relation to them, which was clearly a part of the original plan with the pseudonyms in the first place. In 1848, that is 2 years after the publication of the concluding unscientific postscript, Kierkegaard wrote a retrospective overview of his works entitled The Point of View for My Work as an Author. He only decided to publish a short version of this in 1850 under the title On My Work as an Author. But when the point of view was discovered among his manuscripts after his death, his brother, Peter Christian Kierkegaard, published it for his deceased brother in 1859. In these works, Kierkegaard reflects on his many books and their different relations to one another. In an entry from his journal NB10 from 1849, the same period, Kierkegaard indicates that his entire literary production is to be understood as a, quote, unified project. He refers to what he calls a, quote, comprehensive plan in the entire production. This is surprising to some readers, since we know that Kierkegaard was an outspoken critic of any form of systematic thinking. What could this then possibly mean when he seems to regard his collective literary work as a kind of unified system? This is what's explained in the point of view. We know that Kierkegaard published works both under pseudonyms and under his own name. The pseudonymous works treat different themes such as aesthetics, philosophy, and psychology, while the signed works tend to be more religious. Indeed, the signed works were primarily edifying or upbuilding discourses, which is a genre closely akin to sermons. It might further be claimed that the pseudonymous works were aimed more at a more sophisticated audience, since they at times refer to academic debates and quote in foreign languages. By contrast, the edifying works seem to be directed to the common believer, who doesn't necessarily have any scholarly training. Kierkegaard's strategy, therefore, seems to have been to try to reach different kinds of people through his writings in a way that was most suitable to them. This meant that he had to write and present the material in different ways to different people. In the point of view from my work as an author, Kierkegaard explains that he intended for the two sets of works to run parallel with one another and to complement and supplement each other. So the idea was that for each pseudonymous work that he would publish, there would also appear a signed work parallel to it. In this way, two different authorships would arise together. Kierkegaard refers to the pseudonymous works as the, quote, aesthetic authorship, and the signed works as the religious authorship. Although it's clear that the pseudonymous works, such as Fear and Trembling, Philosophical Fragments, and The Concept of Anxiety, also treat religious subjects. When one looks at the publication dates of Kierkegaard's works, this conception of his authorship does, for the most part, seem to hold true. Either War was published on February the 20th, 1843, and its pendant, Two Upbuilding Discourses, was published only a couple months later, on May the 16th, 1843. Similarly, the pseudonymous works Fear and Trembling and Repetition were published on October the 16th, 1843, and on exactly the same day, the signed collection, Three Upbuilding Discourses, appeared. One can continue to follow these parallels up to the publication of the concluding unscientific postscript in 1846. Kierkegaard thus created two authorships, side by side. This scheme also shows the importance of the concluding unscientific postscript. As we've seen, it was originally conceived to be Kierkegaard's final culminating work, since he was afraid that he would die thereafter. It also seems to be conceived as the work that brings together the two different strands of the authorship. In the point of view, Kierkegaard writes, quote, "The first division of books is aesthetic writing. The last division of books is exclusively religious writing. Between these lies the concluding unscientific postscript as the turning point." What does Kierkegaard mean by calling the postscript the turning point in his literary work? Kierkegaard didn't die as he expected in 1846, and he found that he couldn't stop writing after the postscript. So he continued his authorship, in a sense starting again anew after the postscript. But the nature of his works after the postscript is, it's claimed, somewhat different. For this reason, scholars tend to divide Kierkegaard's life and work into two main parts. The first part of the authorship, which includes everything from Kierkegaard's initial articles in his first books up until the postscript in 1846, and the second half of the authorship, which includes everything after the postscript and culminates in Kierkegaard's attack on the church and his death in 1855. It's said that while the first half of the authorship gave primacy to the pseudonymous aesthetic works, the second half inverted this, putting the primary focus on the religious writings.
parallel shift can also be discerned in Kierhorn's journals. Kierhorn was an avid journal writer, and he meticulously kept running journals throughout his lifetime. He would buy at the stationery store bound notebooks with blank pages that he would use to write his journals in. People often think of his journals as a kind of personal diary, but this is somewhat misleading, since Kierhorn used his journals for many other functions beyond simply recording the events of his daily life. Indeed, he used these journals for quite different purposes. To jot down a clever turn of phrase or thought, to note something interesting that he had just read, to record something that he could come back to and use in his later writings. The journals also fall into two large categories that correspond temporally with the two periods of the authorship. The first set of journals was given double numbers, AA, BB, CC, and so forth until KK. Kierhorn began his first journal, AA, in 1835 when he was still a student at the University of Copenhagen, and he continued to write in his journal JJ into the year 1846. At the same time as these earlier journals, Kierhorn also wrote a series of notebooks, simply numbered sequentially, that is, Notebook 1, Notebook 2, and so forth until Notebook 15. It's here that we find, for example, his lecture notes to Schelling's lectures and notes to his other readings. When Kierhorn saw that he didn't die as he had anticipated, but he also continued to write journals, after he thought that he had given his definitive statement of his authorship in a first and last explanation, as time went on, he still felt the need to say more, and so he named his next journal that he began immediately after the publication of the postscript, the N.B. Journal. The initials N.B. stand for the Latin words nota bene, or note well. The idea seems to be that these are supplemental remarks or reflections about his authorship. Even into 1847, Kierhorn was still unsure about whether or not he was going to die, and so he continued to write in the journal named N.B., which grew to be very large. At some point, he realized that he was in fact going to live, and so he continued with a new journal, which he called N.B. 2. He continued the sequence of the N.B. journals until his death, with the final journal being N.B. 36. The N.B. journals run parallel to the second half of the authorship and are somewhat different in character from the early journals. While the early journals contain very diverse kinds of material and skip from topic to topic very quickly, the N.B. journals display a greater degree of continuity. Indeed, they contain endless reflections on Kierhorn's self-understanding and his complicated relations to others. In any case, the journals constitute a rich source of information about both Kierhorn's life and works and provide interesting perspectives that are not always afforded in his published writings. The early journals, AA to KK, and the NB journals respectively reflect the two large parts of Kierhorn's authorship. At the beginning of this lecture, we noted that Kierhorn made the strikingly odd claim that he believed that Socrates became a Christian. Now, after looking at some of Kierhorn's important works from the years 1844 to 1846, we can perhaps begin to gain some insight into what he means by this. Usually we associate Christianity with a set of teachings, dogmas, and doctrines. If this is what Christianity is, then surely it can't make any sense to say that Socrates was a Christian or could have become one, since he was never familiar with these teachings and had no way of ascribing to them. But, as we've seen, Kierhorn, through his pseudonymous authors, seems to believe that this is not the true essence of Christianity. To his mind, it's a mistake to think of Christianity as a set of dogmas or doctrines. This is the conception of Christianity that theologians, philosophers, and other kinds of scholars tend to have, but Kierhorn is consistently critical of these kinds of people. He believes that their conception of Christianity is misguided and even corrupt. What then is Kierhorn's conception of Christianity, and what does this have to do with Socrates? This is not so easy to identify or to describe clearly, since Kierhorn seems very intent on avoiding giving us, his readers, any easy definitions or positive statements in this regard.
But we can gain a glimpse of this if we recall the different analyses that we examined in this lecture. Kierkegaard's different authors claim consistently that Christianity is concerned with the inwardness of each and every individual. It's about the passion of the individual in the face of certain ideas that are paradoxical, absurd, and contradictory. This is just the opposite of the conception of Christianity of the scholars of the day, who try to understand and explain the paradox and the absurdity of the key dogmas. But for Kierkegaard, Christianity is all about accepting these in inwardness and passion and not trying to understand and comprehend them. Kierkegaard believes that Socrates can play an important negative role here. With Socrates' critical disposition, he can help us to undermine the different positive doctrines about Christianity. He can help us to return to the paradox, the absurdity, and the contradiction that's intrinsic to Christianity. So if we regard Christianity not as a positive set of doctrines and teachings, but rather as a certain inward disposition that focuses on the individual subject, then we can start to make some sense of why Kierkegaard believes he can associate the pagan Socrates with Christianity. Now, needless to say, this is all very provocative and controversial. Let's together try to evaluate the strengths and the weaknesses of this view and see to what degree it accords with our own modern intuitions. On the one hand, Kierkegaard's view of Christianity as something that's fundamentally tied to the individual subject is highly attractive to many people today. There seems to be something intuitively correct about focusing on the inwardness and subjectivity of the individual when we're talking about Christianity, or indeed religion in general. There's also something attractive about the view that one can believe in the inwardness of one's own heart, but not have to convince anyone else about it. Indeed, on Kierkegaard's view, it would be a mistake to try to convince other people of the truth of Christianity, since this would distort its inward nature. Each individual must come to Christian faith on their own. The most that another person can do is to be an occasion for this, but they can't bring about faith in another person with arguments or other forms of persuasion. On the other hand, there's something a bit unsettling about the radicality of Kierkegaard's emphasis on the subjectivity of the individual. Some people have worried that Kierkegaard opens the door for subjectivity and relativism. If the truth of Christianity is just about my inwardness and my subjective passion, then is there any real connection to any objective truth? Indeed, in the history of the Christian religion, people have always thought that the truth of Christianity is dependent on certain things. For example, that God became flesh and came into the world as a human being, or that Jesus performed miracles and that he returned to life after being crucified. The usual assumption has always been that if these things are not true, then this would undermine the truth of Christianity, and it doesn't really matter what I might think about this personally in my own inwardness or passion. For this reason, critics of Christianity have always attacked these kinds of things to show that they're not credible. But by locating faith in the inwardness of the individual, some people have argued that Kierkegaard neglects this other objective dimension of Christianity. Doesn't being a Christian mean having a relation to these outward objective things? Can one really be a Christian merely by focusing on one's inwardness and ignoring all these things that have traditionally been associated with Christianity? The point here is not to praise or to criticize Kierkegaard's views, but rather to understand them and to fully appreciate their radicality. He raises absolutely basic issues for all of us, even if one's not a Christian or even if one's not particularly religious. He raises the fundamental question that goes back to Socrates. What is the truth? Is it something that's out there in the world, a fact of the matter? When I look out and say that here and now the sun is shining, isn't this true independent of my subjective disposition? Aren't there things like this that are objectively true and that I can give arguments and reasons to support as true? The Earth is the third planet from the sun. A molecule of water contains one oxygen atom and two hydrogen atoms. 2 + 3 = 5. Isn't the truth something that's objective and greater than the personal opinions or dispositions of individuals who might well be confused, mistaken, or deceived? Or is the truth something subjective, something in me? When I read a poem or view a painting, hear a piece of music, I get a feeling that I can't necessarily describe or articulate in words, but that I'm somehow certain about, even if other people disagree with me. I'm convinced that the poem or the painting or the song captures something true and beautiful, even if no one else seems to think so. Or in ethics, I might have a deep-seated conviction that I owe my friend something, even if other people or even my friend himself might not think so. I alone feel convinced of this. When I'm listening to a sermon or reading a sacred text, I might have the feeling of having a personal and special relationship to God, or of a deep conviction of the truth of religion, even if other people might regard me as silly, old-fashioned, or superstitious. I can't point to anything in the world to demonstrate the truth of these things, but I just seem to know them to be true in my own heart. Isn't the truth in these important areas something subjective and inward, as Kehort says? In the modern world, for many people, our intuitions are caught somewhere between these two views. Is the truth something objective, or is the truth something subjective?